Thank you for the opportunity to talk today, and thanks for that presentation, Greg. You're too kind. I wanted to talk today about the human papillomavirus as it relates to head and neck disease, head and neck malignancy in particular, but we'll touch on a couple of benign pathologies as well. And by way of an outline, we'll just review a little bit on head and neck cancer as it relates to epidemiology, the common histologies we see, and then some of the risk factors and how those are changing. And then we'll talk a little bit about anatomy, specifically as it relates to this new HPV-driven process in the oropharynx, and then think a little bit about future directions and how we probably have a golden opportunity to make this a disease of the past couple decades down the road. So it was last year, it marked the 50th anniversary, that Luther Terry published his report as a Surgeon General highlighting the adverse health effects of smoking. This was a kind of a landmark publication at the time. I think it was considered the publication of the year in 1964, the news release of the year. And it really kind of changed the spotlight as it relates to tobacco and human disease. And certainly in head and neck cancer, tobacco remains the most important risk factor for head and neck malignancy. But it's actually a rather small piece of the pie. If you look at all of the deaths attributable to cigarette smoking, it's primarily heart and lung pathology that's driving it. We know that it imparts anywhere from a 5 to 25-fold increased risk of cancer in the head and neck. The same goes with cigar and pipe smoking to a much lesser degree, but still certainly significant. There's a known synergy with heavy alcohol use. And interestingly, smokeless tobacco is relatively much safer. And I always just am so impressed that oral surgeons have gotten the message out, because whenever I ask students, I feel like the first thing they think about is chewing tobacco and oral cancer. Big studies in Europe don't even show an increased relative risk of cancer. So I almost wonder if it's a safer alternative for people who just cannot get rid of the cigarette habit. Since that report in the mid-60s, the prevalence of smoking has gone down dramatically. The population of the country has also gone up. So actually the number of smokers in this country is really about the same. And the number of overall head and neck cancers has been pretty steady because of the increase in population. Worldwide, it's about the sixth most common cancer, and there are a couple of areas of the world where it's among the most common cancers. Southeast Asia has endemic regions of nasopharyngeal cancer related to the Epstein-Barr virus, and in India, there's a popular substance that's chewed called pan or betel nut, and this has a risk factor for buccal carcinoma, and they have a tremendous amount of that. In the United States, it represents only 4% of the malignancies, about 50 or so thousand cases per year. We're going to spend most of the time talking today about the oropharynx, and in the oropharynx, of the different subsets of the head and neck, it's about 12,000 cases per year. The male to female ratio is about 3 to 4 to 1, and that actually turns out to be interesting in ways that I'll talk about in a little bit. As opposed to the larynx, which is a traditional site that has risk factors attributable to tobacco, where there's a similar number of cases per year, again, alcohol, tobacco mediated, and the male-female ratio is 5 to 1. It used to be 15 to 1, but there's been a changing ratio of smokers in this country, so it's now just 5 to 1. The process of carcinogenesis is well known, has been worked up in many different models, and I put this slide here not to go into the details of reviewing it, but rather because I think the process that is being driven by the HPV-mediated phenomena is completely different. So traditionally, we think of this multi-hit hypothesis as leading from normal mucosa to a process of dysplasia, and then when it breaks through this basement membrane, we've got carcinoma. And that slow progression seems not to be the case for the HPV-mediated diseases as it is for the alcohol tobacco-mediated diseases. So there's been a dramatic rise in oropharyngeal cancer, and it's not being driven by tobacco because rates of tobacco use are going down. So if we look at this graph on this side, this is overall incidence of oropharyngeal cancer. This is projected into the future. And this top curve is overall, this in blue is men, And down here is women. So right away, it's been noted that this is a disease that's primarily affecting men. There has been a statistically significant rise in women, but it's to a much, much less degree. Looking at head and neck cancers overall, we can see the trend is going down for the annual number of cases slightly, with the exception of the oropharynx, which is a pretty dramatic difference in the slopes of these curves. So tumors of the oropharynx are by and large squamous cell carcinoma. So that's basically what we're going to be talking today. But by way of just mentioning other things that we do see in this area, the area is composed of minor salivary glands, which can have both benign and malignant pathology. The more common of the malignant pathologies being mucoepidermoid, adenoid cystic, adenocarcinoma. As it relates to salivary glands, the smaller the gland is, the more likely a mass in it is to be cancer. So these are very, very small minor salivary glands as opposed to the large parotid gland where 80% of the time it's going to be a benign tumor. We do see benign tumors in this area less commonly in the minor salivary glands, pleomorphic adenoma being the most common. And then also lymphomas and sarcomas certainly can present in this area as well. So the connection between the papillomavirus and head and neck cancer was first talked about with a retrospective review out of Johns Hopkins, and they looked at 253 samples and found that a quarter of them were positive for HPV, and 90% of those was HPV type 16, and that still remains. HPV type 16 is the most common virus implicated in this disease. What they noticed was that, by and large, these were all in the oropharynx. They had a very characteristic histology, this basaloid appearance. These patients had less alcohol and tobacco use. And even on this very first study, they could see that these patients did better. They had a significant reduced risk of death compared to those patients who had tumors that were not related to HPV. And so there's been a significant change in the incidence of HPV-positive tumors. And this is the a graph just looking at men on the top, women on the bottom, HPV-related tumors going up statistically significantly on the men, HPV-unrelated going down as smoking is going down, fairly flat as it relates to women. There's some other studies showing slight increases in women, but HPV-unrelated in women also going down, again, as we're kicking the tobacco habit. So the papillomavirus is a small DNA virus. There are ever more number being described, 120 plus subtypes. The most important ones for cancer are 16, 18, 31, 33. I've got 16 bigger here because it really makes up 90 plus percent for head and neck and 60 plus percent for cervical cancer. HPVs type 6 and 11 cause warts. And it's the most common sexually transmitted disease responsible for a number of pathologies, including warts, cutaneous warts, genital warts, papillomas, cervical cancer, anogenital cancers, and as we're seeing, oropharyngeal cancer. And again, it was first described in head and neck cancer in 1985, so relatively recent description. So it works by infecting the basal cell layer of the epithelium, which probably plays an important role as to why it infects the oropharynx. There has to be a disruption of the epithelial barrier to allow for the virus to get access to this basal layer of the epithelium. And the tonsils in the base of tongue seem to be the ideal kind of breeding ground, if you will, for this. It's part of immunologic surveillance as tonsillar tissue, and there are these cryptic structures, which I have a slide of in a second that I think we'll highlight, but it allows this virus easier access to these basal layers. It's got 8 genes, 6 early, 2 late genes. The E6 and the E7 oncoproteins are the key genes that are responsible for the malignant potential. So it was identified as a necessary cause of cervical cancer in the 90s, and it has been shown to have a quite variable latency, which makes monitoring somewhat difficult. The majority, again, of cervical cancers similarly are HPV-16 positive. Vaccination has been shown to prevent high-grade cervical dysplasia and anogenital disease, and the first vaccines, Gardasil and Cervarix, have been approved for quite some time. Gardasil approved for men and women, or boys and girls, I should say, Cervarix for just for girls, starting at the age of 9. It's FDA approved, and in the last few months, Gardasil 9. So a vaccine that has 9 different HPV types and includes 31, 33, and a number of other of the oncologic types, primarily for cervical cancer, but is also approved in boys and girls. We also see HPV as it relates to a process called laryngeal papillomatosis. This is primarily a disease we see in children. Children will be born and will develop hoarseness. They'll get these papillomas on various areas of their larynx, presenting with hoarseness and cough sometimes. And ultimately, these children often have many, many, many surgeries until the disease usually burns itself out. This is HPV subtypes 6 and 11, also included in this vaccine, and very rare potential to degenerate into a malignancy. We see HPV in the nasal passage as well, sinonasal papillomas, also called Schneiderian papillomas from the Schneiderian membrane of the sinonasal tract. One subtype of this is something called an inverting papilloma, which usually presents as a unilateral polyp. On this scan, MRI scan, you can see this unilateral nasal mass and with some fluid above the mass, this kind of fibrovascular core here. These can be quite locally destructive. They have a high tendency to recur, and they do have the potential for a malignant degeneration anywhere from 5 to 15%. So they're treated pretty aggressively surgically to prevent that. Back to the oropharynx. Numerous studies across the globe really have demonstrated that if you look at the oropharynx, the percentage of these tumors now that are HPV positive is continuing to rise. And in countries where there's not a lot of smoking, it's 70-80% that are related to HPV. If you look at head and neck cancer, all subsites continued together, it's much lower because all of the other sites of the head and neck really are not HPV-related and are more alcohol, tobacco-related. The question arises, is this a different cancer? Is it a different disease altogether? Well, an argument could be made in some ways that it may be. It's still squamous cell carcinoma. It comes from the same lineage of cells. But HPV-positive tumors really, again, are just the tonsil and the base of the tongue. So we think of the oropharynx. Those are the two structures that really make up almost all the oropharynx, and that's where these come. They have a unique histology. They're not keratinized. They have a poorly differentiated basaloid appearance to them. These are younger patients, still male-to-female ratio of 3-to-1. The risk factors for these, as I'll talk about a little bit more, are not alcohol and tobacco, but rather sexual activity. The incidence of these is increasing quite dramatically. The silver lining is that the survival is definitely much better for these HPV-related tumors. So as I mentioned, the traditional model of multi-hit hypothesis doesn't seem to apply to these HPV lesions. With traditional alcohol, tobacco, you've got mutations in the tumor suppressor genes like P53, downregulation of some of the cell cycle proteins. This is one that encodes for P16, which is important because this is a marker we use for HPV-mediated disease, P16. There's the idea of field cancerization, which was published in the 50s by Slaughter, where all of the adjacent mucosa next to a tumor is somewhere along the line in that progress from normal mucosa to cancer. That does not seem to be the case for HPV. So with HPV, you get degradation of these pathways. So P53 isn't mutated, it's just degraded by the E6 protein. And the retinoblastoma pathway is also inactivated by the E7 protein. This leads to P16 upregulation. And the reason this is important is because we just stain for P16. That's our surrogate for HPV mediated disease, because it's rare that alcohol, tobacco tumors not related to HPV are going to be P16 positive. So again, prevalence over time increasing quite a lot. So this is just a slide from the pathology literature showing increase from looking at all archived samples from the 80s through the early 2000s, showing anywhere from 30 all the way up to 75 plus percent using different modalities sustained for the virus. So Mara Gillison is someone who's done a lot of work in medical oncology as it relates to HPV, and she did a study where they sent out thousands of these swabs and just had people swab their pharynx. And what they found across a broad age range was that 7% of the population were positive for HPV, significant difference between men and women. And there was this bimodal distribution with peaks in the 30s and peaks in the 60s. Among people who had no history whatsoever of sexual contact, it was about 1%, and those who had any history of sexual contact, so 7.5%. So this is just a graph showing this bimodal distribution of the prevalence. And what they found was that the number of sexual partners, oral sex or vaginal sex that someone had had, increased the prevalence of positivity. And this has been demonstrated in numerous numerous studies. Fortunately, not all HPV strains are created equally. And so in this study, HPV-16 positivity, the one that causes almost all head and neck cancers, was about 1%. The peak age for women was different than it was for men. It was in the 20s in women and then decreased, whereas it was more stable across age groups, accounting for some of the bimodal distribution in men. So what has to occur from exposure to the virus? Well, it's going to occur in almost everybody. The strains that one is exposed to are obviously of importance as it relates to the risk of cancer. 16, 18, 31, 33, 35 are the important ones. An immunologic response is going to occur. Either the virus is going to be cleared or it's going to get incorporated. And there are some gender differences as it relates to this for reasons that we don't totally understand. But the vast majority of individuals will have cleared this infection within a year, and 90% by 2 years. But persistence of the virus is obviously a risk factor for cancer. So the HPV needs to integrate to become a risk factor for cancer. And you can see that the HPV DNA is not present in adjacent normal mucosa next to tumors. This has to be transcriptionally active. There's a variable latency for these virally mediated tumors. We see it in cervical cancer, we see it in head and neck cancer, and that can make for somewhat difficult discussions with patients and their families because they want to know, when were they exposed, you know, who is at risk, what do I need to do about this for my family members. HPV has a number of unique features that allow it to evade the immune system. And again, there was a case control study looking at HPV-16 positivity, and people who remain HPV-16 positive have a 14-fold risk of subsequently developing cancer. I think that's interesting because still the vast majority are never going to develop cancer in that. So how is it transmitted, and why is there an epidemic of this now? Well, sexual activity is clearly the most important risk factor. The number of lifetime sexual partners, both oral and vaginal sex partners. Other risk factors, the age of first sexual exposure is very important. Smoking and marijuana use are also risk factors for infection, whether this relates to affecting the immune system or leading to more irritation of the oropharynx and therefore allowing the basal layer to be more exposed to the virus. There are certainly changing social norms over the last couple of decades. The age at sexual debut has decreased a fair bit. There's a rise in the overall number of lifetime partners as well, and this may account for why it's presenting itself now in part. Again, there are gender differences. This is primarily a disease we're seeing of men, and they're more likely to be infected. It's not clear why. If this has something to do with the increased number of sexual partners, a difference in the immunologic response, whether there's something different about having a cervical exposure to the disease prior to an oropharyngeal exposure, it's not clear, but without question, this is primarily affecting men. It has been shown that the virus is cleared more slowly by males, and that may be part of it. Well, wouldn't it be great if we had some kind of a Pap test? That's been revolutionary for cervical cancer, a tremendous cost, but a valuable procedure. Why can't we do some kind of a pap stain for the tonsil? It's worked well, again, in terms of decreasing cervical cancer deaths, would probably be even better if all of the recommendations were followed as they were supposed to in terms of having follow-up testing and such. It is expensive, pap testing is, in the UK study, one life will be saved for every 20,000 Pap tests that are done. So you think about countries where this is clearly not an option, and some of these countries have done some interesting things as it relates to this, like making vaccinations absolutely mandatory, because this is an expense that other countries would simply not be able to bear. So what about the tonsil? We know that the oral infection rate with HPV-16 is about 1%. What about testing the saliva or doing some kind of a swab? Well, you certainly can do that. The problem is that it's not very sensitive if you look at either serum testing or saliva testing, if you combine them. And so it wouldn't be a useful screening tool at that level. There is some data suggesting that post-treatment saliva and serum testing may be of some value. So somebody's had HPV-mediated cancer of their tonsil. They've then had radiation or surgery or whatever treatment is deemed appropriate. Those patients who still have HPV found either in their saliva or their serum have a dramatic recurrence rate. So left here is recurrence-free survival. These patients are HPV negative on saliva, serum, the combination of saliva and serum, and these are HPV positive. So there's a big difference in recurrence-free survival. It doesn't pan out as it relates to overall survival to a great degree, but it may at some point be a useful screening tool and surveillance. So again, this is a disease of the oropharynx, which extends from the soft palate to the hyoid. It is the part of the tongue that's beyond the large taste buds in the back of the tongue, the circumvallate papillae. It comprises two-thirds of what we call Waldeyer's ring, which are the tonsillar tissue that extends from the adenoids in the back of the nose down to the base of the tongue. And again, the pathology that we see in this area is almost invariably squamous cell carcinoma. The subsites of the oropharynx, the important ones as it relates to HPV, are the tonsil and the base of tongue. And again, these are part of the Waldeyer's ring, the immunologic surveillance in the upper air digestive tract. The base of the tongue is a difficult area to see. The tonsils are pretty easy to see in the average patient, but visualizing the base of tongue can be a challenge. As a result, having a low threshold to send the patient to somebody who has the ability to visualize this area with scopes or mirrors and things like that, I think is important. So just as a way of reference, looking at the tonsils, we grade tonsils by size, and the size is based on how far they stick out between these muscular pillars. And so this would be 1+ to 4+, 4+ being your classic kissing tonsil. And this isn't an image to show malignancy, but rather just to show size. We use scopes frequently in our clinics, one reason being that the base of the tongue, which is present right here, just in front of the epiglottis, is difficult, again, to visualize. Sometimes you can't do it with a mirror. But this is a view we get. We're looking at all of these subsites, but as it relates to HPV disease, our attention is really focused right here. So again, why the oropharynx? Well, again, HPV infects the basal layer of the epithelium. And you can see here on this H&E slide that tonsils often have these cryptic structure to them, and these crypts can make the basal layer of the epithelium be very close, essentially, to all of the pathogens of the upper air digestive tract. And this is one of the reasons that it seems that the oropharynx is a site where we see these tumors. Because of this close connection between the basal layer and the basement membrane, the idea of carcinoma in situ is a little more vague in the tonsil. It's very rare that we get a biopsy in the oropharynx that's carcinoma in situ, because usually by the point that it's detected, it's already gone through the basement membrane, given the proximity of these tissues. So the typical presentation of somebody with this isn't anything related to the tonsil or the base of the tongue. It's a neck mass, a level 2 neck mass usually, because these patients often have very minimal disease at the primary site. The throat symptoms they may have can be quite vague. I think Michael Douglas's case a few years back highlighted that. He saw numerous providers and otolaryngologists and had kind of vague symptoms, and it took quite a while to make the diagnosis. Not a bit atypical at all. Pain's relatively uncommon. It would usually be related to a referred otalgia or a pain related to cranial nerves 9 or 10. Difficulty swallowing is pretty uncommon. If you really hone in on the history, they may describe some very subtle changes to the swallow, but not anything that really makes the radar. Voice change is uncommon unless the mass is quite big. And a visible lesion may be absent. It may be absent not because you just can't see the base of tongue, but because it's so small that you can't see it. So when we think about a neck mass in an adult, anyone over age 40, and this is an older slide from our main otolaryngology textbook, we think of the chances of this being neoplastics being quite high. This has probably shifted to a bit younger with HPV, as we're seeing patients even into their 30s sometimes with this. But by and large, I think one takeaway is a neck mass in an adult is cancer until proven otherwise. I don't want to go through too much detail of the staging. The only thing I'd really like to say about the staging is as it relates to nodes in the head and neck, it's based on the size, the number, and the laterality. And the reason that's important is because you jump up to N2 disease if you have a lymph node more than 3 centimeters or you've got more than one lymph node. And that's how these patients present. So these patients almost invariably present with advanced stage disease when they walk into your clinic. Again, so it's typically a neck mass, cancer until proven otherwise in an adult. It's usually going to be stage 3 or stage 4 disease because of it's presenting as a nodal metastases. There are very few symptoms often at the primary site. And that's another thing that is important as we think about how to manage these. The primary can be quite small. The node disease can be quite advanced, and it's often cystic. So a cystic neck mass is not necessarily an infection. It's not necessarily a congenital branchial cleft cyst in an adult. It's, again, cancer until proven otherwise. The nodal disease, its impact on survival, is certainly less apparent for this HPV-related disease. The traditional mantra was, in head and neck cancer, if you've got a neck node, your survival's just dropped by 50%. That's clearly not the case, fortunately, for HPV. So a large percentage of the lymph nodes in the body are in the head and neck, related to the venous structures, and we think about their position, whether they're mobile or fixed, whether they're tender to palpation. These neck masses are often noted shaving. They're not painful, and whether they're changing over time. Sometimes these neck masses in these HPV patients will wax and wane a little bit because they have a big cystic component to them. So examination, the visualization is key, having good lighting, mirrors, flexible scope to see the base of the tongue. The other important thing is palpation. Sometimes you can't see an abnormality that's stuck in depths of one of these crypts, but you can feel an area that's quite hard. So you will gag a lot of patients in clinic trying to determine that. Whether it's fixed to the mandible is going to impact on staging and treatment, and then a good cranial nerve and neck exam, thinking about mobility of the necks, whether they're painful. The workup, we typically start with biopsy and imaging. And the order of that can be important, but in some fashion, you want to get both of those. So an operative biopsy may be necessary if it's not something you can see or approach in the clinic. And the reason I put in here or robot is because there has been this concept in head and neck cancer of an unknown primary. And approximately 5 to even up to 10% of cancers previously were called unknown primary, where they presented with a neck mass, didn't know where it came from. Many of these were undoubtedly HPV-related tumors. Much of the newer work being done, people will go out of their way to make sure that they can figure out where this primary is. If that includes even going to the operating room 2 separate times to first remove the tonsils, then remove the base of tongue tonsillar tissue, there is value in that because it allows, if somebody's going to need radiation, the radiation to be focused to the site of disease as opposed to having to radiate a broad area. We like to try to get biopsies without going to the operating room. It's obviously more convenient for the patient, safer, and there are a number of means we can do that. The predominant way we get the diagnosis initially, because it presents as a lymph node, is a FNA. Imaging-wise, CT, MRI, and PET are all excellent modalities. Things you're going to be looking for, realizing that it's a small primary, large, often cystic lymph nodes. We want to define the extent of the primary, look at the nodal burden, and again, look for distant metastases. PET scan is not mandatory as it relates to the workup for these, but often ends up playing a pretty important part in terms of planning for radiation, thinking about lymph nodes on the other side that might be a little bit enlarged by size criteria. But fortunately, distant metastasis is pretty rare in HPV-positive disease. So this would be kind of an example of what a CT scan might look like. You'll see a heterogeneous appearing lymph node in the level 2 region that's got areas that appear to have a fluid density. And you could see on this is a slight fullness in the tonsil here that would be pretty easy to gloss over. And the PET scan can be helpful in identifying that primary site if you're not seeing it on exam or on just a CT with contrast. So the viral detection, these have a characteristic appearance on H&E, basaloid features, poorly differentiated, non-keratinizing, in situ hybridization, oncogene expression, all these things can be done to demonstrate the HPV, but really what we use is this P16 upregulation. So the oncoprotein E7 inactivates the RB pathway, and it's nearly 100% sensitive. We call something P16 positive or HPV positive when 70% of the cancer cells or more stain positively on this immunohistochemistry. So pretreatment considerations, any head and neck mass where we consider airway safety, these rarely present as an airway problem, but it's certainly on our list of concerns. Dental health is very important. Radiation plays a critical role in the care of these patients, and if you can address any problems as it relates to poor quality teeth prior to treatment, you can prevent a lot of problems down the road. Swallowing function is important both for a primary surgical or a primary radiation therapy treatment pathway, and we have these patients see swallow therapy prior to treatment to establish a baseline and start to get expectations and exercises in mind as they go through treatment. Nutritional deficits, fortunately, are less common in this because these patients don't typically present with dysphagia, but these certainly need to be proactively addressed. And when we think about somebody who's going to get high-dose radiation to the pharynx with chemotherapy, the chances that they're going to have difficulty swallowing through treatment are pretty high, and prophylactic G-tube is not unreasonable consideration. Mental health considerations are also important, something I think we forget a little bit about. Many of these patients have no evidence whatsoever of things like depression, but we were part of a study when I was at the University of Nebraska where we gave prophylactic Lexapro to people who had head and neck cancer, and you could prevent depression in a significant percentage of these patients. And then medical comorbidities also are going to be important as it relates to treatment considerations, renal function when you're thinking about cisplatin, which is the primary chemotherapy we use, and things like that. So the treatment is stage dependent. Early stage disease gets single modality treatment, which is either surgery or radiation. So chemotherapy is not a single modality treatment for head and neck cancer. Late stage disease is multimodality, which is either going to be surgery followed by adjuvant radiation or chemo radiation, depending on the pathology findings, or upfront chemo radiation with surgery reserved just as a salvage treatment. There are differences in HPV positive and negative disease. Can we justify changing our treatment plans based on the HPV status right now? I would say we can't quite. We certainly can adjust our counseling as it relates to the chances that somebody's going to be cured. But in general, we are working on that now in terms of trials. So the traditional surgical approaches were really quite morbid to this area. If it's difficult to see an area, it's going to be difficult to get there surgically. And that's true for the tonsil on the base of the tongue. And there was a shift toward radiation and chemo radiation. There was improved toxicity profiles with the use of IMRT. The number of chemotherapies given with radiation was decreased to a single agent. That has shifted back a little bit over the last decade with some technological advances in surgery. There are transoral approaches now that are much less morbid using either the robot or endoscopes and a technique called transoral laser microsurgery. So the open approaches that we traditionally were done and we still do in salvage cases include mandibulotomy. So this involves splitting the lip, dividing the mandible, and making an incision on the inside of the mouth to get access to the back of the pharynx. This is what the approach would look like. And you see this is quite morbid. You've got to do quite a bit of deconstruction to get to potentially a 2-centimeter tumor in the back of the pharynx. The other approach used was a pharyngotomy. I think this is another image from our textbook. I think this is interesting because they actually have this nerve labeled wrong in our ENT textbook. This would be the superior laryngeal nerve. So you open into the pharynx between the hypoglossal nerve and the superior laryngeal nerve. And this, again, could get great access to the back of the tongue, but you've got to disrupt a whole plexus of nerves you can't see. And these patients often have difficulty with aspiration afterwards. So primarily, these approaches are used in our hands for surgical salvage when radiation has already been done and is not an option to be used again. So here's just an example of what that could look like to have open access. By and large, the scars often heal reasonably well, but there is a significant morbidity. This mandible site is not always going to heal perfectly. You can get a non-union there. There's a much longer recovery. These patients typically are going to require some kind of reconstruction with insensate tissue from, say, the forearm or from the thigh. And so the techniques we use now include transoral laser microsurgery and TORS, or transoral robotic surgery. Both of these involve working through the mouth, very similar to how we do a simple tonsillectomy, except we have a little bit better tools to get around corners and to see the interface of normal and abnormal tissue better. And we think about what is involved in a wide local excision. If you've got a 1 centimeter tumor and you're going to take a 2 centimeter margin, the volume of tissue you're going to have to remove is going to be much different than if you take a smaller margin. So better exposure does allow for still an oncologically sound surgical procedure, but a somewhat narrower margin so that you're removing less normal tissue adjacent to this tumor. And I think this is one of the reasons why TORS and TLM surgery works, is because you're removing less tissue and you're taking down less tissue to get there. So the robot has the working console and then the robot, which is docked up at the head of the bed. This is what it would look like. You'd have an assistant at the head of the bed suctioning and retracting a little bit. It has advantages in terms of the articulation of the handpiece, angled cameras. The optics are very, very good. Something like this, you would have a very hard time doing without a robot. This is the epiglottis doing a base of tongue tumor. You could do this with the other technique, the transoral laser microsurgery, but the traditional way we remove a tonsil, where we just use a bovie and a mouth gag, you never see this area. So how do people do with these surgeries? Well, one of the larger publications, which was a single institution review from St. Louis, looked at tonsil and base of tongue cancers treated with transoral laser microsurgery. The majority of these were early stage, but a third of them were advanced stage T3 and T4 disease. Again, the vast majority of these are HPV related, which goes with the trend. Pretty significant percentage of these patients received adjuvant therapy, and their overall survival, 2 and 5 years, was excellent, 90 and 80% in head and neck surgery. We don't really see these numbers unless it's very, very early stage disease or it's HPV-mediated disease. And the number of these patients that were G-tube dependent at 5 years was 3 to 4%. Looking at survival, our hallmark is 5 years, five-year survival in the 70% range, which is excellent. And there was a difference based on the T stage as well, as one might expect. Margins are important. So TLM, transoral laser microsurgery, it's like a Mohs procedure. It's not an en bloc resection. The first cut you make, if you do this according to the discussion, is you make a cut right through the center of the tumor, and you visualize the interface between the tumor and the normal tissue. So the key to success is negative margins and communication with your pathologist. And this was nicely demonstrated in their study. When they had negative margins, the survival was significantly different than when they had positive margins. So stage for stage, HPV-positive patients did dramatically better. HPV-negative patients down here, HPV-positive patients up here. And this has been borne out in numerous studies. One of the indications for adjuvant chemotherapy for head and neck cancer is whether it extends outside of the capsule. 63% of these extended outside of the capsule. This didn't have any association with the survival status, and we're trying to figure out what extracapsular extension means in these HPV-positive tumors. N2 or greater necks were also not negatively prognostic. So typically, the more advanced stage of neck disease, the worse somebody's going to do. Seems not to be the case as much with HPV disease. And again, the overall survival, HPV positive versus HPV negative at 5 years, 85 versus 30%. So it's not good for HPV negative. Radiation and chemotherapy, IMRT has kind of revolutionized treatment of head and neck cancer in a lot of ways. It's got equivalent efficacy to the standard approaches with a much improved toxicity profile, sparing important structures for function, the salivary glands, and swallowing musculature. Chemotherapy, the primary agent we use is cisplatinum. Cetuximab is also an agent that can be used with radiation. There are other chemos that can be used and different induction protocols using some of these other agents, but by and large, cisplatinum and cetuximab are the two agents. Overall rate of local regional control with IMRT for this is excellent, 90% or greater, very similar to Bruce Hoey was able to demonstrate with the transoral laser microsurgery. And again, anywhere from 2 to 4 year follow-up, 80 to 90% local regional control. So we're not going to make a good argument for one treatment modality versus the other based on survival. So when do we operate? When do we chemo-radiate? Disease control-wise, HPV does better independent of the modality used. What we really want to avoid is triple modality. We want to avoid surgery followed by chemo-radiation because that seems to be more than we should have to do given that these patients do so well with chemo-radiation or with surgery followed by radiation. HPV negative, we're still doing very poorly, and so a rationale for surgical intensification can be made. So questions we have to ask ourselves, is the lesion amenable to a transoral technique? You have to have access. If the patient is trismic, if they have a narrow mandible, if they've got a large tongue that makes them a difficult malampati class, they're probably not going to be a great candidate for a transoral approach. Vessel control. If they have a retropharyngeal course of their internal carotid artery, that's going to put that at risk, and that's not going to be a good candidate for a lot of the transoral techniques. There's also a learning curve to TLM and robotics, and so certainly as one begins the process of doing these, the earlier lesions that are in accessible areas are going to be better candidates. We also need to think about G-tube dependence rate. 3 to 4% for the largest TLM study, and modern techniques pretty similar for radiation. This 30% was an older study. So starting to think 10, 15 years down the road as opposed to 3, 4 years down the road is going to drive some of our treatment choices. Can we de-escalate treatment? Well, there's a current trial being undertaken for a P16 positive that we're a part of, looking at T1 and T2 lesions of the tonsil and the base of the tongue. They have a transoral resection, any approach, so that's either transoral laser microsurgery or a robot, and a neck dissection. And then they're randomized to treatment based on the findings of the neck dissection and the primary site. And the randomization is either 50 gray or 60 gray. 50 gray of radiation to the pharynx is going to have very minimal in terms of long-term side effects or even short-term side effects for that matter. And so if we have equivalent survival with this lower dose of radiation in these intermediate risk patients, then we will have a good rationale for de-escalation therapy. So this is an ongoing trial right now. What about HPV negative? Is there a rationale for surgical intensification? We know we're not doing well. These patients don't have good 5-year survival. Well, this is a study that's also going on. This is a pretty interesting study insofar as it's randomization to either chemo radiation. Many would consider the standard of care right now for these patients versus an upfront surgery and neck dissection followed by risk-based chemo radiation. And so this will be interesting. This is going to be more difficult to accrue because this is just, again, HPV negative tumors. So I just wanted to touch on a couple last things, some common reactions to diagnosis. My family, obviously, are concerned first and foremost about prognosis, and it's nice to be able to give them a better prognosis in comparison to much of what we do. They also have a lot of questions about transmission, feeling guilty, whether past relations, questions of fidelity come up. How could my spouse have this? I've never had HPV. What risk do the spouse have? What about the children? And going to the internet leads to a lot of fear. There's a real media bias. It's true that HPV positive patients are more likely to have had multiple sexual partners, but many, many of them have a low number of lifetime partners. So HPV positivity absolutely does not equal highly sexual active or promiscuity. And the other thing I think it's important to say is that HPV-positive cancers don't just occur among non-smokers. We think of this as being the one that's not related to tobacco. Smokers get this too, and in fact, smoking's a risk factor in some ways. So another important thing to keep in mind, those patients who are heavy smokers are intermediate risk in that context. Well, should my partners be worried? There are very, very rare cases of couples developing HPV-positive cancers simultaneously or in succession. There was a Swedish database suggesting a slightly higher risk to men for partners of women who have had cervical lesions. But the thing is that exposure has already occurred. It's occurred probably 10, 15 years ago. So there isn't a lot that really needs to change as it relates to sexual activity between partners. There's no consensus recommendation on this. But couples don't need to change their sexual practices based upon this. Unfortunately, we don't have a pap smear equivalent for head and neck cancer, and we do offer head and neck screenings, say here yearly, but the truth is that head and neck screenings have only been demonstrated to be helpful in areas where there's endemic disease, like in India with betel quid chewing. So for women, regular pap smears are certainly important, and again, we don't have a well-established oropharynx screening process. Dentists are certainly aware of this. This is in the dental literature, and they're looking for this as well. The good news, HPV cancers have a better prognosis, whether you choose surgery or chemo radiation, and we're trying to see about de-intensification of treatment. There's less risk of developing a second primary tumor down the road, and the traditional staging probably doesn't apply. So we have to start thinking about longer-term side effects from our treatments that we're rendering, as many of these patients are going to be cured of the disease. In the future, well, we have vaccines. We have vaccines for the virus that causes this disease. Gardasil 4, Cervarix, and now Gardasil 9, having replaced Gardasil 4. They're approved for boys and girls. They've been shown to prevent cervical dysplasia, genital warts, anogenital disease. They have not been demonstrated to prevent oropharyngeal cancer. This is, you know, similar to the prevention of cervical cancer. It's going to take years to definitively demonstrate that. The same goes for the oropharynx. We don't have that precancerous lesion of the oropharynx that we can screen for the same way you can for cervical cancer. So it's going to take more time to demonstrate any efficacy. But awareness of the disease, I also think, is important, as there are different patterns of sexual activity among teenagers now than in two, three decades ago. So we have a long way to go on vaccination. To achieve any kind of a herd immunization, we have to get much, much better vaccination rates. In 2010, 48.7% of girls aged 13 to 17 had received one of the three-part vaccines. That's just one. 30% had received all three parts. We haven't improved much on that since then. There were issues related to costs and insurance coverage. I think these have largely been overcome. A lot of misconceptions as it relates to the risks of the vaccine. There are numerous monitoring boards looking at the safety of these vaccines, and they are conclusively safe. The idea of therapeutic vaccines is also being studied, but has not achieved a mainstream application to this point. This is just a diagram looking at the percent of female adolescents who have received all three. Wisconsin has 37.5%. The states that are best are ones that have mandatory vaccination to get into high school, where you can certainly opt out, but the default is to get the vaccine. Wisconsin data. The adolescent vaccine platform includes Tdap, meningococcus. Meningococcus achieves a lot of media attention. Anytime somebody gets meningococcus, I mean, it makes the news. This is an extremely rare disease, though, and our rates of vaccination here are, 75-80%, whereas HPV is quite common, and all three in women or girls is 35%. All three in males is about 16%. One publication that gets cited over and over and over suggested that HPV of the oropharynx would overtake cervical cancer in 2020. It's already happened in Wisconsin. HPV-related oropharyngeal cancer has passed cervical cancer, several years ago. So the time is certainly now. And one of the things that we're looking at is we want to get a sense from primary care providers of the level of awareness of the association between HPV and oropharyngeal cancer, because I think that vaccinating boys is going to be the strongest thing we can do to prevent this from continuing the trend it's taking now. And happy to entertain any questions.